we had in the earlier lecture seen the making of the constitution of 1791 and the overthrow of the Bourbon monarchy. The overthrow of the monarchy was followed by the establishment of a republic in September 1792. France won the famous victory of Valmy, which was greeted by Goethe as the harbinger of a new age. They also defeated the Austrians at Jemappes and moved into Belgium. There had been success at the southern front as well. Nice and Savoy in Italy had been taken. A freshly recruited revolutionary army, ill-equipped and not very well led, had really achieved a miracle. The convention had several political groupings. The Girondins had the majority. The Girondins were so called because a majority of their members came from the province of Gironde. They were also called Brissotins, following their leader. The Girondins represented the higher bourgeoisie. They were for open trade, free trade, for unbridled profit, in fact. They were the mountains. They were called mountains because they occupied the high benches in the hall of the convention. The mountains' major support came from the Jacobin Club, the members of the Jacobin Club, and the sections of Paris. This is where the common people crowded, and they obviously would have preferred a controlled economy in order to ease the economic situation and ensure a larger availability of essential commodities. In between were the plains. They occupied somewhat a centrist position. They sided with the Girondins to start with, but later they gradually moved towards the mountains, who would very soon be known as the Jacobins, really. This is how Barras, Cambon, or Carnot gradually moved towards the mountain or the Jacobins. The trial of the king started in December, and on 21st January, he was sent to the guillotine. This had a tremendous impact, not only on France, but on the whole of Europe. The Girondin ministry, however, failed to guide the government or France either to safety or to find solutions to the economic problem. The one answer that they had to the economic problem was to supply or increase the supply of assia or paper currency. But this had a disastrous consequence because the value of the assia by February 1793 fell to about 50% of its original. The crisis on the economic front was continuing. Bread was not only dear, it was becoming scarce. There was a good harvest in 1792. Even then, the peasants were reluctant to sell their produce because they were reluctant to take useless paper currency for their labor. Now, the Girondins were supporters of free trade, whereas the people now wanted some kind of control so that there is greater availability of food grains. The opponents of the Girondins were trying to make contact among themselves at Lyon, Orléans, or Rambouillet, and many other provinces. There had been contacts made. The sections of Paris declared in February 1793 that liberty was useless without food, without bread. They demanded the control of the grain trade. It is in this context that the war situation gradually galvanized the people into demanding and getting a more extreme and almost an emergency form of government. In the spring of 1793, the war started going against France once more. Belgium was lost. Enemy was almost inside France. The Spaniards had crossed the Pyrenees. Even at the southern front, on the Italian border, there had been very serious reverses. The crisis was now dual in nature. There was external and there was internal as well. The weakness of the Girondin ministry compounded the problem. The mountains took advantage of this, and with the support of the Jacobins and the Sansculottes, they were seeking to radicalize the government, to make a more strong government which would be able to establish its will on the events. And this is how by July we move towards an extreme form of government, which has been variously described as the reign of terror, as a revolutionary government, or as Buloazo would put it, the Jacobin Republic. It was an emergency form of government when terror was used as an instrument of enforcement of certain policies, and particularly in eliminating those who were perceived as the enemies of the revolution. Now, what are the instruments of this exceptional form of government? There was a Committee of General Security established in 1792, after the convention had started. They were to look after law and order, generally speaking. Now, the Committee of Public Safety was set up in April 1793 with Danton and Cambon among their members. Executive authority was now sought to be concentrated in the hands of this Committee of Public Safety. There was a revolutionary tribunal which had been passed by the convention at the proposal of Danton. The revolutionary tribunal will try all who were suspected to be against the revolution. The convention also decided to send representatives on mission, that is, deputies would be sent to the army so that they would also be there would be a political control of the army. Representatives, that is, deputies, were also sent to the provinces to mobilize support for this a more radical and a more strong form of government gradually. There was also the law of suspects. The law of suspects authorized the definition of suspects, elimination of the suspects through a trial in the revolutionary trial. But most important was the law of the maximum, which decided the price, maximum price of bread and certain other commodities. Very soon, there would also be a minimum, law of the minimum. This was to ensure minimum wages. Now, it was seen that politically they were moving towards a more controlled economy, because this would have gone against the interest of the upper bourgeoisie who wanted free trade. But a control of the economy would enable the people to get things at a cost that they would be able to support or afford. Now, the law of maximum and the law of the minimum are therefore very crucial to understand the direction in which the revolution was being taken, but whether the revolution really reached there or not is what we're going to see. The mountains had forced the Girondins to take certain extreme measures, but they were not very happy to take that. They set up a commission of 12 and decided to use the revolutionary tribunal against their enemies. For example, Marat was sent to the revolutionary tribunal, but he was acquitted. The commission of 12 then ordered the arrest of men like Hébert, Daubsin and Varlet. They were radicals. Hébert particularly would, in a few months' time, lead the de-Christianization movement. He published a paper called Le Père Duchesne. They were also arrested and were being tried. In late May, the Jacobin Club declared that it was in a state of insurrection. You can see that the movement was towards making an emergency form of government and to centralize power in the hands of the Jacobin deputies or the mountain deputies. They would constitute the Committee of Public Safety, and the Girondin ministry seemed to be dilly-dallying and were rather weak in taking very strong decisions. On 29th May, 33 sections constituted what they called to be an insurrectionary commune. This became the revolutionary commune of Paris. The commune also had sections. There were 48 sections in Paris, and there were sectional assemblies. The sectional assemblies are where the people participated almost directly and were in a position to influence the decisions of the government. So in a way, the involvement of the people were not only radicalizing the revolution, but also democratizing it in the process. Because the convention was elected on the basis of adult male suffrage, and now even the sectional assemblies witnessed a kind of direct democracy. I'm not suggesting there was direct democracy, but people were involved from outside in the meeting of the sectional assemblies. For example, they demanded certain things. These sectional committees, the revolutionary commune, decided once again to have insurrection, to journées, or to observe a revolutionary day. It was really an insurrection. On 31st May and 2nd June, they moved towards this, and they forced or tried to force the Girondin ministry to accept their demands. What did they want? They wanted purge of the convention of the Girondin deputies. They wanted the committee of 12 to go, or the commission of 12 to go. They wanted the sectional committees to meet regularly. They wanted the sectional members of the sectional committees to get an allowance of some money. They wanted price of bread to be fixed at 3 sous per loaf. And they wanted the state to acknowledge that they had a responsibility to help the poor, the indigent, and the disabled. Disabled meaning those who had been disabled by the war. Now the Girondin ministry didn't really respond. On 31st May, they simply accepted the revocation of the Commission of 12. On 2nd June, they accepted the removal of 29 Girondin deputies from the convention. But this was not enough to satisfy the revolutionary commune or the insurrectionists, and indeed this inaugurated the fall of the Girondins. After these two insurrections of 31st May and 2nd June, the Girondins fell from power, and the Committee of Public Safety had all the power. Now the Committee of Public Safety, there was of course the convention which still controlled the proceedings, but executive power was concentrated in the hand of the Committee of Public Safety. They had again a dual problem. First, they had to find solutions to the problems both at the front and inside the country. Secondly, they had to contain the revolutionary enthusiasm of the people. Because after all, the Jacobins also represented a section of the bourgeoisie, the middle bourgeoisie in fact. The Girondins had unleashed another problem on the government. It was the Federalist Revolt. Federalist Revolt was a revolt of the provinces against the domination of Paris. But this is where the Girondins were trying to find their support base and thus embarrass the government. This had to be taken control of. There was also gradually a movement, a counter-revolutionary movement in certain places, particularly La Vendée in northwest of France, a place called La Vendée. There was a peasant revolt. It was actually a peasant disapproval of the levée en masse or the conscription, but gradually they were appropriated by the counter-revolutionary forces, which were joined by the royalists and the refractory clergy gradually. Now, the existence of a counter-revolutionary movement and the need to bring the war again to France's favor actually outlined the problems that the Committee of Public Safety now confronted. What came as another, or almost the last straw, as it were, was the murder of Marat by a woman, Charlotte Corday. The assassination of Marat was seen as the product of a conspiracy, the Girondins and other counter-revolutionaries, and it galvanized the people once more. Jacques Roux, who was the leader of a group known as the Enragé, or the Enraged, or the Angry Group, he demanded radical economic solutions. He wanted death penalty for the hoarders. They wanted a movement against hoarding and profiteering and black marketing so that food was available aplenty. The Paris Stock Exchange was closed down. They moved against the churches, and they decided, Paris Commune particularly, decided that there should be one bill per church, and the rest of the church bills would be melted down and converted into cannons to be used in the war, because there were need for ammunitions aplenty. The Paris Commune also prohibited all religious processions and ceremonies outside the church. So, you know, radicalization of the revolution affected different aspects of French life, political, economic, and religious even. The Committee of Public Safety was reconstituted in 10th of July. Danton was excluded. Robespierre was to join it on the 27th of July. And after that, Robespierre's leadership really comes into focus gradually. Another great reverse was the surrender of Toulon. Toulon surrendered in September to the British, and this was dangerous. Finally, another insurrection of 5th September in Paris really inaugurated the terror. It was now announced very clearly that an emergency government is taking shape and that terror would be the order of the day. The convention agreed to the trial of the Girondin deputies, and a whole lot of changes were made. Radical deputies were brought into the Committee of Public Safety as well. It was decided that 40 sous would be given to the members of the sectional committees for the meeting. The law of suspects would now clearly define the suspects and would give a greater power of surveillance to the Committee of General Security. But what was even more important was the introduction of a new revolutionary calendar. Olar has called it the most profound anti-Christian act of the revolution. The government of France, it was proclaimed, would be a revolutionary until peace was achieved. Now, what was the different dimensions of the terror? Politically, it's the revolutionary tribunal and the law of suspects that, together with the guillotine, represented the terror. The law of suspects allowed the CPS and the government to move against anyone who was suspected of being against the revolution. The revolutionary tribunal very quickly tried the cases, and the guilty, more often than not, were sent to the guillotine. And in this way, a whole lot of people in the last 3 months of 1793, 277 people were sent to the guillotines. Madame Roland, Bailey, Barnave, and of course the Queen also perished at the same time. Total number of prisoners by December was more than 4,500. At the same time, the CPS and the convention were also trying to contain the radicalism of the people. And the target of attack were the women's societies. By the end of October, all women's clubs and societies were closed down, and the revolutionary government now created a new law which centralized power in the CPS, or the Committee of Public Safety, and terror was being bureaucratized. In the economic aspect of that terror, we find that there was an attempt to put the maximum of the price and the minimum of the wages, and the aim of ensuring the happiness of the common people is very clear. Now, it is possible to argue that they were obliged to take these steps because of the pressure of the people, generally speaking. But they did it. There were also a permission to create revolutionary armies. These revolutionary armies were not armies which fought a war, but there were, Richard Cobb has shown, there were more than 22,000 such armies all over France. They were manned by these common people, and they wanted to find out economic offenders, particularly those guilty of hoarding, black marketing, and profiteering. there were also a minimum wage to be ensured for the common people. A national food commission would coordinate the activities of different agencies to ensure that food was made available at a reasonable price. In this way, the economic terror was also taking shape. To put it briefly, there was an attempt to control the economy, and a controlled economy was inimical to the interest of the upper bourgeoisie. So it's a middle and lower bourgeoisie, along with the common people, who were looking after their own interests. There was a religious aspect of the terror as well. There was an attack on Christianity. Hebert led the de-Christianization movement. There was new festivals introduced, secular revolutionary festivals. It was made obligatory to put the red beret and to use the tricolor, which was the emblem of the revolution. You know, very typical image that one has is of a sans-culotte with a red beret on his hand and the tricolor atop a pike with which he roamed the streets of Paris and certain other countries. Gobel, the Bishop of Paris, was compelled to resign, and in the Notre Dame, they celebrated the Festival of Reason. It was converted into a Temple of Reason indeed. Robespierre gradually came to power. He was against the policy of clemency that Danton and others were showing. The war, by December, end of 1793, the war had been brought under control. The enemy had been pushed outside, the Spaniards had been pushed back to Spain, and a revolutionary army was doing well. Toulon, the siege of Toulon had been relieved, and in this, one person played a role far beyond his rank. His name was Napoleon Bonaparte. We'll hear more of him later. Robespierre took control by December, and in December 93 and February 94, he gave two very crucial speeches, which also alarmed his enemies. He said that in a revolutionary situation and in an emergency situation, one needed both virtue and intimidation. Intimidation without which virtue is important. Virtue without which intimidation is dangerous. Therefore, he wanted a mix of both what he understood as virtue and intimidation or terror. Robespierre was against de-Christianization because he believed in a supreme being, and he later even introduced the worship of the supreme being, but that was not before June 1794. The government inaugurated a series of welfare measures that almost conjured the picture of a welfare state. It is during this period that they abolished slavery and slave trade, notwithstanding the fact that in the plantation, the planters needed them. Slavery was abolished. Finally, the period from April to July had sometimes been called the period of great terror indeed. On 10th of June, this was the law of 22nd Prairial, the Revolutionary Tribunal was reconstituted. Even earlier, Danton had perished, as did many other relatively moderate, or those who were in favor of clemency, Danton, Desmoulins, Delacroix, Philippot, etc. Hébert, Vincent Rossin, those who were in favor of de-Christianization, the radicals, they had been sent to the guillotine. Jacques Roux, the radical leader of the Enragé group, had also been guillotined earlier. So they were trying to steer a middle role, to keep on the terror, to keep on the emergency form of government, to give some sops to the people, but at the same time, they were dismantling the initiative of the people. They would now try everyone, and the only death penalty, if found guilty, was death penalty. The accused will not have any right to hire a lawyer or even to defend himself. The accused was totally defenseless. This really sent a thrills of acute fear into the enemies of Robespierre. Robespierre, Couthon and Saint-Just virtually represented a triumvirate. His enemies were trying to regroup, and they successfully did it. On 9th of Thermidor, that is 26 July, Robespierre gave another speech to the assembly, and this again sent a message of fear or confirmed the message of fear. And Robespierre's virulent attack on his enemies forced them to take action. On 9th Thermidor, that is 27 July, Robespierre, Couthon and Saint-Just were arrested and they were sent to the guillotine the next morning. Along with them, more than 70 of their followers of the commune went to the guillotine, and the red terror of the Jacobins was substituted by the white terror of the Thermidorian reaction. This is how the Jacobin Republic, as Bourgeoisie calls it, ended, as did the Reign of Terror. Terror did not end, but the Jacobin terror did end on the 27th of July. What is the incidence of the terror? Donald Greer had earlier estimated that between 35,000 to 40,000 people died. Estimates vary, but what is strange is that nearly 84% of the dead belonged to the Third Estate. It was ironical indeed. But it was also a period when the revolution was thought to be democratized, the new constitution which could never be put into action, which was never implemented, but was overwhelmingly endorsed by the people by vote. They tried to create a welfare state, they tried to empower the people, but were also afraid of empowering the people. They wanted an empowerment that would be controlled. Yet, it represented a dream. As Richard Corbett said, that the end of the Thermidor, that is 27th July 1794, their dream lay strewn like so many pieces of a broken toy butterfly. But as Bourgeoisie says, what is important is the dream, not the failure. It represented an ascent to democracy. The dream was for greater democracy. It did not succeed, but the failure was not the last word. The dream would be realized much later. But terror, the killings notwithstanding, there was a positive side to the revolutionary government as well.